Section 5.2, the addition rule and complements. We will look at these three objectives in this section. Objective 1, use the addition rule for disjoint events. Two events are disjoint if they have no outcomes in common. Another name for disjoint events is mutually exclusive events. We often draw pictures of events using Venn diagrams. These pictures represent events as circles enclosed in a rectangle. The rectangle represents the sample space, and each circle represents an event. For example, suppose we randomly select a chip from a bag where each chip in the bag is labeled with the digits 0 through 9. Let E represent the event choose a number less than or equal to 2, and let F represent the event choose a number greater than or equal to 8. We see that these events are disjoint as shown in the figure below. So let's look at the probability then of our event E. We know that it's the number of outcomes in E divided by the total in our sample space. So we see that in our circle E, there are 3 outcomes, and the total number in our sample space is 10. We have 0 through 9, so the 1 through 9 is 9, plus the value of 0 gives us 10, which would be equal then to 0.3. The probability of our event F would be the number of outcomes in our event F divided by the total number of outcomes in the sample space. So the number of outcomes we see in our circle for F would be 2 of them, divided by 10 again. So we see that we get 0.2. So if we wanted to look at the probability of either event E occurring or event F occurring, meaning that either we choose a number less than or equal to 2, or we choose a number greater than or equal to 8. That would be equal to the number of outcomes that are in either E or F divided by then the total number of values in the sample space. So remember that with the OR, we can add the two together. So we have E had 3 and F had 2. So in E or F, we have 5 divided by 10 again, which would be 0.5. So we see this would be equivalent to adding the probability of E and the probability of F together. So we have 0.3 plus 0.2, which again gives us 0.5. So this leads us to our addition rule for disjoint events. If E and F are disjoint or mutually exclusive events, then the probability of E or F occurring is equal to the sum of the two individual probabilities, the probability of E plus the probability of F. The addition rule for disjoint events can be extended to more than two disjoint events. In general, if E, F, and G each have no outcomes in common, they are pairwise disjoint, then the probability of E or F or G or so on occurring is equal to the sum of those probabilities. So let's look at an example. The addition rule for disjoint events. The probability model to the right shows the distribution of the number of rooms in housing units in the United States. We want to first verify that this is a probability model. Remember, to be a probability model, it must follow both of our rules for them. The first rule being that all the values must be between 0 and 1 inclusive, and the second one that they must sum to 1. So in looking at all of our probabilities, we see that they are between 0 and 1. And when we sum them together in a calculator, we see that we do get 1. So this is a probability model. Part B, what is the probability a randomly selected housing unit has 2 or 3 rooms? So the probability of it having 2 or 3 rooms. We see that these are disjoint events, So this would be equal to the probability of having 2 plus the probability of having 3. So now we can look at our table and we see that the probability of having 2 rooms was 0.032. We'll add that then to the probability of having 3, which is 0.093. And when we add those together, we get 0.125. And this is our probability a randomly selected housing unit will have 2 or 3 rooms. For part C, what is the probability a randomly selected housing unit has 1 or 2 or 3 rooms? So we're extending it now to 3 different values. So the probability of 1 or 2 or 3 rooms. The same as we did in B, we can say that this is then the probability of 1 room plus the probability of 2 rooms plus the probability of 3 rooms. So from the table, the probability of 1 room is 0.010 plus for 2 it's 0.032 plus for 3 it was 0.093. And when we sum those together, we get a value of 0.135 as our probability that our housing unit has 1 or 2 or 3 rooms. Objective 2, use the general addition rule. The general addition rule says that for any two events, E and F, the probability of E or F occurring is equal to the probability of E plus the probability of F minus the probability of E and F, which would be where they overlap. So in this example, we'll illustrate that general addition rule. Suppose that a pair of dice are thrown. We'll let event E be the first die is a 2, and let event F be the sum of the dice is less than or equal to 5. And we want to find the probability of E or F using the general addition rule. So here we have a picture of all of the possible outcomes when a pair of dice are thrown. So I've highlighted here all of the outcomes where the first die is a 2. And now let's highlight all of the outcomes where the sum of the dice is less than or equal to 5. Notice that there is some overlap. So let's calculate our probability for event E. We'll see that that is the total number of outcomes in E, where the first die is a 2, divided by our number of outcomes in the sample space. So we had 6 outcomes where the first die was a 2. Out of our total, which is 36, which will reduce down to 1 out of 6. So the probability for F, where the sum of the dice is less than or equal to 5, will be the sum of our outcomes in F divided by the total number of outcomes in the sample space. So again, we're dividing by 36, and the total number of outcomes where the sum is less than or equal to 5 is 10. And this will reduce down to 5 out of 18. So now let's look at the probability of E and F occurring. So that will be the number of outcomes where there was an overlap between E and F divided by the total number of outcomes in our sample space. So we see here that we had a total of 3 places where these overlapped out of our 36, and that reduces down to 1 out of 12. So using our rule, if we want to find the probability of E or F, the rule states that we take the probability of E plus the probability of F minus the overlap, the probability of E and F occurring. So our probability of E, remember, was 6 out of 36 plus the probability of F, which was 10 out of 36, minus the probability of E and F, which was 3 out of 36. Notice I did not use my reduced fractions here. Since I wanted to combine them together, I wanted them to have the same denominator, so I stuck with the ones that had 36. which will allow us to now add 6 plus 10 and subtract 3, and we will get 13 out of 36 as the probability of E or F occurring. Objective 3. Compute the probability of an event using the complement rule. The complement of an event. Let S denote the sample space of a probability experiment, and let E denote an event. The complement of E, denoted E with a superscript of C, is all outcomes in the sample space S that are not outcomes in the event E. So let's look at the complement rule. If E represents any event, and E with a superscript of C represents the complement of E, then the probability of E complement is equal to 1 minus the probability of E. So we see a picture here where our rectangular region is our entire sample space. Our circle is our event E, and so everything outside of the circle within our rectangular region represents our E complement. So let's look at an example where we'll illustrate the complement rule. According to the American Veterinary Medical Association, 31.6% of American households own a dog. What is the probability that a randomly selected household does not own a dog? So the probability that they do not own a dog, that would be equal to then 1 minus the probability that they do own a dog. So we have 1 minus our 31.6%, which we can divide by 100 to get 0.316 as a decimal value. So we see then that the probability that they do not own a dog is 0.684. So let's look at another example using complements. The data to the right represent the travel time to work for residents of Hartford County, Connecticut. What is the probability a randomly selected resident has a travel time of 90 or more minutes? The first thing we want to do is total the values. So we see that when we sum all of our frequency values, we get a total of 393,186 residents in Hartford County. So then the probability a randomly selected resident will have a commute time of 90 or more minutes, we look at the table till we see 90 or more, and we see that that frequency was 4,895, which we'll divide by 393,186 and get a value of approximately 0.012. Now we want to compute the probability that a randomly selected resident of Hartford County, Connecticut will have a commute time less than 90 minutes. So since we have all the data values, we could actually sit and calculate this by summing all of the others and dividing by the total. But we can also utilize complements to do this, noting that the probability of less than 90 minutes will also be equal to 1 minus the probability of 90 minutes or more, which was what we found in part A. So that'll be equal to 1 minus our 0.012 value we just found, and we see that we get 0.988. So sometimes using the complement of our event will make computing probabilities a little bit easier.